This sequence from my holiday to Singapore was edited entirely in the new Insta360 mobile app version 2. If you already understand the basics of the new app, but you're not sure how to edit multiple clips together into the same sequence, like the one you just watched, in this video, I'll show you how I edited this exact sequence step by step and how you can edit your own videos just like this one right inside the Insta360 mobile app. Now, if you want to learn how to create shots like the ones I'll be editing in this video, inside my 360 Video 101 course, I share all of my best shooting techniques for Insta360 cameras, including where to position the camera for best results and how to make everyday shots look cinematic. If that sounds useful, then follow the link below to learn more. Now, I have already covered the basics of the new Insta360 app in a previous video, so if you're starting completely from scratch, you may want to watch that video first, which I'll link below. Big thanks goes out to Insta360 for sponsoring this video. Now, without further ado, let's edit. So to access the multi-clip editing menu, we're going to head down to edit at the bottom right here. And at the top, you'll see this option, create a video. If you tap that, it will now prompt us to choose the clips on our camera roll, which we've already downloaded, that we want to use within this edit. To isolate just the videos, tap videos up here, and to select a clip, just tap the circle in the top right of the thumbnail. So I'm going to choose that one, this one, and this one here. And now I'll tap next. This has now set up our video editing timeline. Before we edit, I just want to draw your attention to this settings menu up here. And this will allow us to change between original mode and proxy mode. Proxy mode essentially downscales the files to make editing faster, which it then reconnects at the end with the high quality files. So if you know you've got a slow phone, you'll want to choose proxy mode. If you don't, just keep it on original. So at the bottom, you'll find the project's timeline. If you tap and slide it across, you can watch back your clip like this. And I'd also recommend pinching to zoom out to get a wider perspective of your timeline to navigate through clips a bit faster. To play back your clips, just tap the play icon at the bottom of the viewer. You can also just tap the screen to pause and play. And usually the first part of any edit is getting rid of the top and tail of the clips. This is essentially the part where you're turning on the camera and then turning it off again at the end. And to do that, what I'm going to do is zoom right out. Then here under edit, I'm going to drag the outer handle here across. So by doing this, it's essentially changing the starting point of this clip. So I want it to be at the soonest usable point, which I think is about here. Likewise, I'll go to the end of this clip and do the same thing. I'll tap the edge, drag it across until about there. You can always just look around your clip if you're not sure exactly where you are. Now I'll repeat the process with all four other clips. Okay, great. So I've removed the top and tail. However, I've also realized that I added the wrong clip into this sequence. I know I've got a better shot of these sculptures on my camera roll. So if you ever want to delete a clip, just tap on it. And here under this submenu, there are a few options. One is volume. So if you ever want to mute your clip, just drag it all the way to the bottom. Then there's split. So if you want to split a clip in two, just tap that. But then there's also delete, which is this trash icon here. So I'll tap that to remove it. And now I'm going to re-add the correct clip, which is this one here. If you ever want to reorder the clips on the timeline here, just long press one of them. And here you'll see the icons have become small. And then it's just a matter of simply dragging it across to the correct position you want it. Okay, so we've got our clips on the timeline in the right order with all of the usable bits. Before we reframe, I just want to walk you through this menu down here because it can get confusing, but it doesn't have to be because of all these options here that you'll find in the main menu, there's really only two options where we'll be spending the majority of our time. There's 360 reframe and edit. If you tap edit, this will lead us to the menu we were just in, where you can adjust the clip length, add new clips in, and do a couple of other effects. The other menu is 360 reframe, and this is where we do all of our reframing. Also up the top right is the aspect ratio option. So if you want to change your project's aspect ratio, if you're editing reels, it will obviously be 9:16. 16:9 if you're editing for YouTube, 1:1 if you want a square, and 2.35 to 1 if you're pretentious. That joke never gets old. So while I will be editing this as a 16 by 9 aspect ratio, I'm going to do it in 9 by 16, just so you can see the bigger screen in this tutorial. Then I'll change it back to 16:9 at the end. At the bottom of the viewer, you'll also find undo and redo if you ever want to change anything you did with one tap. And there's a full screen option here for watching back your clips in full screen. All right, that's all the boring stuff. Now it's time to get on with the show. And that is reframing and retiming these clips so they look awesome. And the place we're obviously going to do that is here under the 360 reframe menu. And there are a whole bunch of ways you can reframe your shots. I counted them. There's at least six different ways, so I won't bore you with all six. Instead, I'm just going to go straight to the one that I recommend, especially for longer projects, and that is manually keyframing. So my idea for this clip is to make it a hyperlapse of the bus driving along the road, turning around and ending up at the flower sculptures. So if you're ever editing hyperlapses like this, you'll want to reframe your shots first and then add speed second. So I'm going to reframe this shot by moving the screen around and zooming in a bit. I'm pretty happy with this. So I'm going to lock it in place by tapping the keyframe icon down here. Now I'll move the timeline along until the next point comes that the viewpoint turns. So I can see it's straight, so I don't need to do any reframing yet. I can see around here the road is starting to bend and this is making the shot go out of center. So what I'm going to do first is move back to the last point where it was still in center, and I'm going to add another keyframe there to lock it in. So now our next move is going to be between that keyframe and the next viewpoint slightly turned, which is here. I'll add another keyframe, and I'll keep repeating this process to keep the road perfectly centered in frame. It always helps to watch your video back as you're reframing just to make sure it looks the way you intended. Sometimes if your keyframes are too far apart on the timeline, the middle section can get messed up, so it's important to check everything. Alright, this is looking good. I've added keyframes all the way along this shot to keep the road in the center of frame. So hypothetically, if you didn't want to use the hyperlapse effect and you just want to play back your clip at normal speed, this shot would be done. There's nothing else to do, and you could move on to the next clip. However, I shot this clip with the intention of turning it into a hyperlapse, which means the next step is going back here to the main menu, and now under edit, I'm going to tap the speed option. And here we can speed up either the entire clip or just a segment of the clip. I'm going to choose entire clip to keep things easy, and generally the best speed for a hyperlapse is around 16 times, which is fast, but not too fast that everything's a blur. But of course, with every shot you take, you'll want to experiment with this. For shorter shots, you'll need to go slightly slower, around 6 to 8. But if you have a couple of minutes of footage you're working with, like I do, then crank it up to 16 and tap tick to confirm. The only thing left to do with this clip here is add the motion blur effect. And this can be found here under Motion ND. So if you toggle that on, now, when we export, this clip is going to have the full motion blur effect. You can customize this, but I wouldn't bother because the automatic settings are pretty good. Now I'm going to move on to the other four clips by following the same process, by first reframing and then secondly adding speed adjustments, like so. All right, that's all done. And the next thing that you'll want to know about when you are manually keyframing like we've done here, which is definitely the best way of reframing your shots in my opinion. However, sometimes you'll realize that you don't quite like the perspective you chose for one of the keyframes and you'll want to change it. Well, that's very easy to do. So let's say we don't like this one here. We want it to be further up, kind of like this. Well, it's really as simple as just making the change and then tapping update keyframe. And voila, this keyframe down here on the timeline has now been updated. Or maybe you realize that you added too many keyframes and you want to get rid of some. Well, that's as simple as tapping the delete keyframe icon here, like that, and it's gone. Generally, I'd advise you to use as few keyframes as you can get away with. Often, instead of doing lots of little moves like this, you can even just remove some of the middle ones. So my idea here is I'm rotating this tiny planet. However, it doesn't need heaps of keyframes. It just needs two or three to keep me in the center and the planet rotating the whole time. And this will inevitably make the transition between the keyframes smoother and less jarring. Another great option when you're editing this way is that you're also not locked into any one way of reframing. So here with this shot inside the Cloud Forest Dome in Singapore, really amazing place to visit if you ever get a chance. But I've decided what I want to do here is basically like a spin, and I just wanted to go at an even pace. Well, there's an even simpler way of doing that than keyframing. So firstly, what I'm going to do is move the playhead to the first frame I can get to that is just after the last keyframe I set, which is here. And now I'm going to choose movement. And here the app has a bunch of preset movements that will apply to your timeline automatically. So I'm going to be looking for just a straight pan all the way across, which will be 360 left. So if I tap that, here we go. It's automatically applying a camera movement without any keyframing needed at all. So I'm going to tap tick to approve that. And now you'll see that it's highlighted that part of the timeline in blue. If you want to extend the length of that camera movement, just tap and drag the outer edge. And if you wanted to break away from keyframes, you could also use other types of reframing like record, tracking, and multi-view. However, generally I find adding these manual keyframes is the right choice in 90% of situations. Okay, so now I'm going to go back to the main menu. And the next stage in polishing this edit and making it even more seamless is adding transitions between my various shots. Right now I've got them as a hard cut, which is okay, but we can definitely improve this by adding transitions. And to add one, you'll see this white box in between the clips. If you tap on that, that will bring up the transitions menu where it has a library of preset transitions. The best ones I've found have been zoom cut and blur cut. If you tap one, you can preview it. And these ones are especially good for forward facing movement. So I can see zoom cut is working the best here. So I'm going to tap tick to apply it. Now I'll move to the next transition, tap it, try some transitions, see what works best. And blur cut works better here. So I'll approve that. Definitely take advantage of this transition option because these are well done transitions. They're not basic ones you'll find in many video editors. Okay, so we've got most of the video edited at this point. So now it's just a matter of adding the last minute things to finish it off. There are a bunch of options here like music, where you can find a bunch of tracks here in the Insta360 app. I don't necessarily recommend these since some of them have been flagged by YouTube. You can also extract music from clips on your camera roll, which really isn't ideal. I had to cheat and use a workaround where I added a music clip to a random video clip and airdropped it to my phone so I could then extract it through the app and add it to my timeline. So hopefully Insta360 improved this with future updates. You can add text and stickers, either just like a plain text box like this. They've got text templates. Let's say you want to add a location, you can do so here. And these can be resized and repositioned by just dragging them around the screen and then tapping on it if you want to change the text, like so. But no, I'm not going to be adding this to my video. They've also got some silly stickers here if you really want. I wouldn't bother too much with the rest of these from the main menu. They're just the most basic effects that look a bit gimmicky, but if you want to use them, then go for it. But if we go back to the edit menu here, one important one you will want to use is color, and this is color correction. If you want to do a fast and very basic color correction, tap color plus and turn it on. And this will add a basic color correction to your clips as well as sharpening them up a bit. And it's not bad. If you do use it, I'd probably keep it around 30. And if you want to apply this to all your clips, just tap apply to all and then tick. Personally, I prefer manually color correcting so I can get the colors looking exactly the way I want them. So instead of color plus, I'm going to choose adjust. And here you'll find more manual controls over your color. I've got an entire video on my channel covering color correction, which is the one before this one. However, I'm going to turn the vibrance up a little bit. I'll turn the highlights down a touch and the shadows up and apply this to all. Great. Those colors are looking really good across the board. I wouldn't bother too much with the other color correction options unless you're shooting underwater, then you want to use AquaVision. All right, so we've got this video fully edited and it's now time to export. To do so, go up the top right here and here under the export menu, we're going to tap where it says 1080p and this will bring up a secret export menu where you'll select video quality and drag this slider all the way up to 4K. This makes sure we're exporting at the maximum resolution possible. Then I'd recommend dragging your bitrate up to roughly 100, which is definitely more than enough for a smartphone edit. And that's it. Now I'll tap export to phone and voila. So there you have it. That's how I edited this really cool looking montage in Singapore. I can't wait to go back. It's an awesome city, and this video is definitely reminding me of it. The only thing I wasn't able to do in the app is add the sound effects, which I did myself in DaVinci Resolve while I was editing this video. So that turned out super awesome. I do also just want to be real with you in terms of the time it will take you to edit a sequence like that. Even though it lasted 30 seconds, the editing obviously takes much longer. And I'd probably say for the majority of it, like 80%, it took me around 15 minutes. But then for that final 20%, like getting every last transition right and changing the reframing by a millisecond or two to just sync it perfectly with the music, it took at least half an hour longer, meaning I ended up going through 5 to 10 versions. This is usually part of the editing process if you are someone who wants to spend the time to get it right. But if you're not, just be aware that this is the downside of using the mobile app, is that it's a bit more fidgety when you want to make those last minute changes and just change those little things. It's not super easy, and the touch interface gets a bit tiresome after a while. Hence, I wouldn't use the mobile app for videos any longer than about a minute. Anything longer and you'll want to go over to your computer and use Insta360 Studio. And if you can relate to being an OCD person like me and doing anything it takes to get the perfect shot and edit it the perfect way, inside my 360 Video 101 course, I share 10 years worth of 360 video knowledge to help you avoid making all the mistakes in the book like I did when I first started and waste endless time doing so. In the course, I teach simple shooting and editing techniques that I've refined over the years to produce stunning results with my Insta360 camera every single time. If you want to learn more, just follow the link below. Now, the final thing you need to know about this multi-clip editing menu is, let's say you finished editing, at least for now, but you want to go away and come back later. Well, if you just tap X at the top left, this will automatically save your entire editing timeline into the drafts folder, where you could easily come back to it at any point in the future, and it will reopen the edit and everything will be exactly as you left it. Now, if you see yourself using the Insta360 mobile app a lot in the future, in this video here, I share 10 hidden features that you can find within the app that will make the editing and reframing process of your 360 videos so much faster and smoother. And all 10 of these features are hidden in plain sight.